Okay, we'll get started now. Thank you all for joining us today for our final seminar in Ukrainian Studies of the spring term. On behalf of HURRY, I'm delighted to welcome today's speakers for a discussion of Margarita Balmaseda's new book, Russian Energy Chains, The Remaking of Technopolitics from Siberia to Ukraine to the European Union. In particular, our panel will address the question posed in the event title, Ukraine in Russian Energy Chains, Threat or Temptation. You can find more information about our speakers on our website, so I will keep introductions very, very brief. Margarita Balmaseda is a professor of diplomacy and international relations at Seton Hall University and currently the Petro Jacek Distinguished Fellow in Ukrainian Studies here at HURRY. Her fellowship project is titled Mariupol Between Oligarchs, Russian Aggression, and Global Metallurgical Markets. Margarita is joined today by Paul Danieri, András Deák, Andrian Prokip, and Benjamin Schmidt. Paul Danieri is a professor of political science and public policy at the University of California, Riverside, and former Sklar Research Fellow at HURRY. Paul's research examines the international and comparative politics of the post-Soviet region, in particular Ukraine and Russia. András Deák is a senior research fellow at the Institute for Strategic and Defense Studies, University of Public Service in Hungary. His research focuses on energy policy and economic processes in the post-Soviet space. Andrian Prokip is a senior associate at the Wilson Center's Kennan Institute and an energy analyst at the Ukrainian Institute for the Future, an independent think tank in Kyiv. His areas of expertise include the Ukrainian energy sector, energy security, and renewable energy. Our moderator, Benjamin Schmidt, is a postdoctoral research fellow and project development scientist at the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. He previously served as European Energy Security Advisor at the US Department of State, where he focused on transatlantic interests in relation to Russia's energy activities. So the plan for today's event will be to start with about a 30-minute presentation or so by Margarita, followed by responses from our three discussants. After that, we will take questions from the audience, which should be posed in the Q&A window on Zoom or in chat if you are joining on YouTube. So Margarita, first let me congratulate you on the release of your fantastic monograph, which I do have here. So with that, Margarita, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. It is a tremendous pleasure to be doing the first presentation of my book, which was released yesterday at HURRY. HURRY has been part of my life for the last 20 years, and I cannot imagine being able to understand Ukraine the little I do better than through what I have learned through HURRY about all aspects of Ukraine. And I am so honored to have Paul Danieri, András Deák, Andrian Prokip, and Benjamin Schmidt as co-panelists today, because they bring to the table not only a lot of expertise on Ukrainian energy policy, but a larger, very unique view. And in particular, Paul, András, and Andrian have helped me very much in conceptualizing a lot of issues related to this project. So I'm going to use a PowerPoint, but mainly to highlight some key points. And I'm sure that we will have a lot of issues for discussion. I know that the audience is a very distinguished one, and I want all of you to feel confident, not only to ask questions, but to raise issues of importance. And I'm sure this will not be the last time we will be discussing the role of Ukraine in energy chains in Europe. Can you all see my presentation? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to be talking about this new book, But I want to give you the framework of why the idea emerged for this book, what I try to do with it. And then I'm going to be simply talking about one particular aspect and one sliver of the book, which is the issue of threat and temptation. It's impossible for me to try to cover everything in this book. I was working on it for almost 7 years, but I want to give you a hint of some of the issues and then try to focus on the issue of threat and temptation. So if we, sorry, I think I need to do something so that I can move. Yes. So, sorry. Okay. So if we go to the prehistory of this book, it all started with the situation 20 years ago, 15 years ago, when everybody was talking about the Russian energy weapon. Undoubtedly, the Russian energy weapon exists, but I personally was not very happy with the literature based on that because it had a number of problems. First of all, it treated energy as undifferentiated, as a single thing without distinguishing between types of energy, which I found very problematic, especially here in the US, that was the case. It did not treat technology seriously. And in particular, I was worried and troubled by the fact that it treated countries that depended on Russia for energy as more objects than subjects. It did not really give countries like Ukraine a lot of space for agency. And I found that very problematic because it kind of reified the idea of Ukraine as a non-state, which is a very problematic one. So what I tried to do at that time is to, as a reaction against that, I tried to say, okay, I'm going to look not simply at the dynamics of supply, but I'm going to look at the energy, quote unquote, dependent state. I'm going to look at that internal domestic politics black box. Let's try to see what agency these states have, what that agency is intermingled with, and what can we learn from that. So over about 15 years, I looked at that black box. I looked at the winners and losers of different ways of organizing energy relationships with Russia. I looked at the issue of governance. I look at the issue of whether energy policies actually do take shape as energy policies or whether they are simply another element of a hijacked state. And of course, I look at the issue of corruption and governance. So as part of this attempt to understand that black box, I wrote three books. One was specifically devoted to the issue of why Ukraine did not seem to have a proactive energy policy in the first 15 years of its independence. And this book is almost only about corruption. And that's not a surprise because this was a key element of Ukrainian energy policy during this period. In a second book, I try to understand how various post-Soviet states that depended on Russian energy managed that dependency, how they dealt with that dependency. And what I found through that work, and I look at the case of Lithuania, at the case of Belarus, at the case of Ukraine, I did field research in each of these states. And what I found through that work is that not only the political system in each of these three states affected the way they dealt with their energy relationship with Russia, but in an interesting circle effect, the way in which the energy relationship with Russia was dealt with or managed fed back into the political system and affected the further development of that political system. This is something we will be discussing briefly today as well. And finally, I also wrote a separate book in which I look at how the ways in which a small state deals with its energy dependency, both physically and in terms of discourses, can actually give that state counter power vis-a-vis a larger patron state. And this is a book focus on Belarus, but it could be applied to other cases as well. So I had a background on the topic, but as I continued to work on that black box, I started to realize that corruption was not everything. I started to see that there were very ambiguous attitudes, a lot of ambiguity in the relationship with Russia. yes, a lot of that ambiguity had to do with corruption, because corrupt actors, and we know that very well from many energy actors in Ukraine, could feed off from dependency on Russia. But even if we let corruption aside, I saw in Belarus, in Lithuania, in Ukraine, in different ways, a tension between, on the one hand, trying to become more independent of Russia, having diversified infrastructure, having alternative supplies, but on the other hand, wanting to continue to be part and to continue to be central to those energy chains having to do with Russia's energy exports. Supply chains having to do with the physical supply of a good and involving transit, for example, value chains, production chains. Part of this had to do with the fact that being a part of those chains gives you leverage vis-a-vis your supplier. And some of you who are in the energy field may remember a lot of the discussion in the 1990s about a duopoly involving Ukraine and Russia in gas supplies, where Russia supposedly had a monopoly of supplies and Ukraine supposedly a monopoly in transit. So being part of those chains allowed some leverage, but being part of those chains also allowed to access economic gains, for example, through the issue of transit. So that ambiguity is something that I want to discuss today. Again, this is only one small element of the larger set of issues discussed in the book, but it's, I think, a very central one as we try to understand Ukraine in the last 30 years and Ukraine going forward. So what I saw through that work, even when I was focusing on governance and corruption, I saw that even beyond corruption, there were hopes or ideas pulling those states, pulling Ukraine away from Russian energy chains, the desire to diversify, the desire not to be dependent on that energy. But at the same time, there was a desire to maintain leverage and to participate in those profitable value-added chains. And that is the ambiguity that I really try to understand in this book. So from that baggage, what did I try to do in this particular book? Why? What did I try to do differently? So I understood that relationships were not only about threat or about Russian weaponization of energy. I knew that there was something to be gained by different actors. But how to understand this? The best way to understand it is by looking at the entire chain. So those profits, those advantages of being part of the chain of Russian exports do not come simply at the moment of supply. They come through participation at different stages in the value chain. So I understood that I would need to look at the entire value chain. And if you simplify it, basically a typical value chain in this area of the world would be a value chain and a supply chain starting with the upstream of production, the midstream of processing and transit, and the downstream of final users. Geographically, this has largely production or upstream in Siberia, midstream in other parts of Russia, but also very importantly, Ukraine, and downstream with end users in Western Europe. Of course, there are end users in Russia, there are end users in Ukraine, but the most profitable for Russian exporters have been Western Europe. And what I try to do in this book is trying to understand how this process works differently for different types of energy. I will get into that in more detail in a moment, but I needed to look not simply at supply chains or value chains in abstract, I needed to look at concrete value chains and see what happened throughout that value chain. So after a lot of looking in the dark and a lot of searching, I chose three exemplary value chains for three types of energy. One for natural gas, one for oil, and one for coal. Of course, there are dozens or hundreds of value chains. If you look at this line, for example, in the case of natural gas, we have the value chain going from Novourengoy in Western Siberia through Ukraine to Germany. There are many other ways in which, of course, natural gas from Russia comes to Germany, for example, through the Nord Stream pipeline and other pipelines. So these are only exemplary chains, but through the in-depth study of these exemplary chains, I could understand where was threat and temptation and how the nature of the energy type would affect this. So in the book, I try to answer basically three questions. The empirical question, which I think is going to be the most interesting perhaps for our discussion today, is how did participation in those particular chains of Russian exports affect the power relationship between actors? Is our view of power going to be the same once we understand that it's not simple supply, but it's a relationship that is much complex and much longer and has to do with an entire value chain? But I also had a very serious theory question, which I found the most interesting and also the most challenging, and that is, how do the differences between different energy types affect what happens in those chains? How do the different physical characteristics of different types of energy affect what you can do? In a nutshell, they affect what you can do because the physical characteristics of different types of energy affect what technology you can use, affect what infrastructure you're going to use, affect what you can do with that energy. And I will briefly talk about that in a moment. But historically, I also wanted to understand how did participation in those Russian energy chains shape the political life in these states, and in particular in the case of Ukraine. So I try to do this. I have, as I said, a very serious theoretical question, but at the same time, I wanted to write a book that could be useful to a larger number of people, not simply people interested in IR theory or energy theory or materiality. So I try to encompass in a single book several types of energy: natural gas, oil, coal, three large areas: Russia, Ukraine, the European Union. I try to do this in a friendly way through the travelogue of three molecules, which are traveling from Siberia to Germany via Ukraine. So kind of helping the reader along, but being conscious of the fact that technology is very, very important. I wanted also to give the reader something to chew on concerning technology. I wanted to help the reader understand how technology plays a role. So the book deals a lot with technology, but it tries to do it in a way that is reader-friendly. It has a separate appendix explaining some of the technological issues for each of the types of energy. And I hope that will make readers understand that technology matters and that it's possible to grasp it even without being a hardcore energy technology expert. So when we're talking about threat and temptation, yes, I'm going to be focusing on Ukraine today, but we know that that has also been the case with other former Soviet states. We know that from the case even of Lithuania, which is one of the energy-dependent former Soviet states that most decisively tried to diversify. We know that Lithuania tried to maintain that role in oil, in natural gas. In the case of Belarus, we know that participation in those value chains and those export chains is actually the biggest source of income and stability for the Lukashenko regime. But we also know that that is also the case with European Union states. We know that EU policy, EU discourses tell us about the EU desire for diversification away from any single source of energy, both area-wise and energy type-wise, but we know that EU companies benefit tremendously from participation in those Russian export value chains, and we see that most clearly through the case of Nord Stream. So the threat and temptation is not unique to Ukraine. I'm going to get into the issue of Ukraine's role in Russian energy chains for a few minutes, but I want to emphasize, again, Ukraine is not simply an object of Russian policy. Ukraine is not simply collateral of something larger. Ukraine was key, for example, to the boom in Soviet oil and in particular natural gas exports to Europe in the 1970s and 1980s. If you have not read the wonderful book by my colleague Per Hoxelius, Red Gas, Russia and the Origins of European Energy Dependency, I would greatly recommend that you do. That book makes clear not only the important role played by Ukraine in the very first deliveries of natural gas to Western Europe or to today's Western European countries, but it also, if you look at it from a Ukrainian perspective, it makes clear the very important technological role which Ukraine played in Soviet natural gas exports. And if you continue the story continues to play. Without Ukrainian storage facilities for natural gas, without Ukraine's very intricate geology and intricate set of pipelines, the Soviet Union and today Russia would be unable to manage the pressure of its export pipelines going into Western Europe. I don't have time today to get into the technical side of the issue, but if you look at chapter 4 in this book, which is devoted to natural gas, it's called Managing Pressure. As it turns out, managing the pressure in your pipeline is key for the entire process. And Ukraine played a very, very important role here. So this is one example of how looking at technology helps us understand the role of Ukraine in these chains. So Ukraine has been not simply a receiver, it has been central to that export chain in its high day, transiting more than 80% of Russian natural gas exports to Western Europe, more than 50% of oil exports, and also playing an important refining role. It's a bit different now, but I want to emphasize how important Ukraine was in these chains. And again, how important Ukraine was in the development of that whole system of Soviet gas exports to Europe, which is important not simply as a supply issue, but it's a system of energy interactions that actually created a particular set of governance rules, which continue to be tremendously important in that area. So let's look very briefly at that threat and temptation through different types of energy, looking specifically at Ukraine. We know natural gas the best because it is in the case of natural gas that supply cutoffs have been the most prominent and have been the most politically resonant and have been very and very blown up by Russia as a way of making a statement. We know that the threat comes from that threat of supply cutoffs of, or came from that, from the threat of price increases, more recently from the threat of Russia reducing or cutting off Ukraine from the transit. We know that all of this led to Ukrainian vulnerability, and this is something where I want to make a nod to Paul Danieri's 1999 book, I believe, on Russian-Ukrainian energy relations, where he talks, Russian-Ukrainian economic relations, where he talks a lot about the issue of vulnerability and the theory behind this. But at the same time, in the case of gas, we saw a lot of opportunity for arbitrage gains, that is gains or profits from different prices in different markets, lower prices in the Russian market, a bit higher prices in different markets in Ukraine. And even higher prices in Western Europe. The possibility of gains from the role of intermediary companies that did not supply the natural gas, but made it possible for that natural gas to be supplied. And of course, the temptation of, or the advantage of, the ability to receive transit fees. If we look at the case of oil, we also see the threat of supply cutoffs and price hikes. The temptation is a little bit different because the pricing schemes in oil change earlier. So the ability of making arbitrage gains in the case of oil was limited. But for example, Ukraine's role in the transit of Russian crude oil exports actually was related very closely to the survival and the boom of the Ukrainian refining system. And this was a way in which profits could be accessed through participation in the Russian export chains. In the case of coal, the situation is a little bit more complicated for a variety of reasons, in particular because when we are talking about coal, we are basically talking about two types of coal that intersect and interact. Coking coal that is used for metallurgical production, and so-called steam coal or brown coal or electricity coal that is used for electricity production. Let me give you a hint that I found my work on the coal chapter for this book the most interesting work I have done in a long time, and that's why my hero project is about metallurgy this semester. What we saw in the case of coal, and in my chapter on coal here, I focus on coking coal, is that, yes, Ukraine was dependent on Russian coking coal, not because Ukraine did not have its own coking coal, but because of a variety of reasons, did not have enough, it was not of enough quality. But at the same time, there was the temptation, there was the advantage that could be gained through that whole metallurgical chain, which is the one that I follow in chapter 6 of this book, because those supplies of coking coal, that process that coking coal made possible, Ukrainian but also Russian coking coal, fueled the entire steel boom that we saw in Ukraine in the 2000s, a steel boom which actually allowed Ukraine to float or to move ahead of what had been the deepest economic crisis in its history, and which actually propelled not only the wealth of key Ukrainian oligarchs, I think the names Rinat Akhmetov, Serhiy Taruta, and Viktor Pinchuk are familiar to you, but actually through the way that industrial process worked, allowed a particular political system, in particular that related to the Party of Regions, to stay in power, allowed a particular use of electoral machinery to keep this system in power, but also allowed the instrumental use of the threat of unemployment, the threat of miners' unrest, the threat of Donetsk separatism to be used instrumentally for these oligarchs to gather even more subsidies from the state and to control policy even more clearly. So here you see threat and temptation working in a somewhat different manner, but also both aspects are there very clearly. So to wrap up, I want to flag a couple of issues about threat and temptation as we look at the future. Chapter eight, in this book talks about the end of some supply chains, the end of some value chains. We know that Ukraine's role in the transit of Russian gas has diminished tremendously. We know what happened to the oil chain. So these value chains are changing. What happens to threat and temptation? And what does it mean for Ukraine? So I just want to end my presentation with a couple of things to think about for you and for the panelists and to discuss later today. So we often talk about Nord Stream, the threat of Nord Stream. We sometimes talk about the Russian naval blockade in the Azov Sea and the Mariupol blockade, which is blocking a lot of those steel exports related to coking coal that I work with. But we do not often talk about other things. And I want to flag you to the importance of new spaces, new ways of thinking about energy space and new geographies. I want to flag the issue of what could be Ukraine's role in a new European energy space? What could be Ukraine's role in a new global geography of energy that is not so much related to Russian and Ukrainian fossil fuels, but related to other types of energy? So when we think about energy space, let's remember that we are not simply talking about just space or just inches or kilometers. We are also talking about regulatory regimes. And one of the issues I discuss in the book is how different regulatory regimes create regulatory governance nodes, which in some cases are as important as technological nodes, such as a pipeline or a refinery. And what we see here when we think about space is that that space is changing, not because the space itself is changing, but because the governance of that space is changing and is intersecting with technology. So that type of a particular way of looking at that energy space, a way that was co-created by the Soviet exports boom in the 1970s and 80s, is changing, in part as a result of European Union attempts at market liberalization, in part as a result of the movement towards decarbonization. And basically what we have is a clash of two different ways of looking at energy space. In this case, I'm going to focus on natural gas. I think most of us are most comfortable with natural gas. And basically we have an old view of looking at natural gas space in Europe based on the idea of fixed routes. Fixed routes, not simply because the pipeline is a route in itself, but because of the way governance of the sector and the contractual framework of that sector worked, earmarked natural gas molecules from A to B, tied particular molecules to particular contracts. In particular, that system was specifically designed to prevent competition between gas from different areas or gas from different parts of Russia. And basically, this kind of view of energy space is the kind of view that is intimately related to the idea of transit fees and transit as a concept. But there's a new way of looking at energy, and in particular, a new view of looking at natural gas trade in the EU, new but developing already from the 2003 Natural Gas Directive of the EU 18 years ago, where the idea is not so much of molecules which are contractually tied to particular contracts and which cannot compete, but rather the idea of anonymous molecules competing with each other in hubs, zones, and even when transit may continue in a technological manner, it's being eased out as a concept and creating a different way of looking at energy trade. I try to find a couple of ways of showing this pictorially. The example here is not from Ukraine, it's from Austria. And on the left side, you see the continuation of the natural gas pipeline, a Baumgarten hub, and then moving towards Germany and then south. In my book, I discuss the route that goes to Germany. But conceptually, this is changing in the European Union to the idea of natural gas hubs where those molecules compete and are not tied to one particular route. So what does this mean for Ukraine? Well, as we have seen from the debates on Nord Stream, both Ukraine and Russia are still tied to the old view of energy space. Molecules going from A to B. In the case of Russia, very strong interest in making sure those molecules do not compete. In the case of Ukraine, while there is an interest in a more liberalized market and not being tied to a single supplier, there is a tremendous interest in remaining part of that export chain, as we see from the case of Nord Stream. Why? Because of transit fees. They are significant. But most importantly, because, again, going back to the technological issue of the importance of pressure in a natural gas system, remaining part of that system, maintaining a certain level of load in your natural gas transit system allows the entire system of natural gas supply in Ukraine to remain viable. If you don't have pressure, it doesn't work, and it doesn't work in Chernivtsi, and it doesn't work elsewhere in Ukraine. So that has been important for Ukraine. And politically, remaining part of those chains is also important in terms of pressure in another set of understandings, in the understanding of creating a relationship that is not simply a bilateral relationship with Russia, but making European Union consumer states and the EU also dependent on Ukraine's role, therefore triangulizing the relationship. If you look back at the 2006, 2009 natural gas crisis, you know that the European Union played an important role. Had Ukraine not been so important for natural gas supplies to European Union states, probably the European Union would not have been so interested in finding a solution and in supporting Ukraine. So all of this calls into question the issue of how is Ukraine going to manage or balance itself between threat and temptation, but also between old and new energy chains, not simply energy chains in Europe, not simply old and new conceptualizations of natural gas contracts, but more broadly. How is Ukraine going to reshape its energy role in a world where the combustion engine may give way to the electric engine, which would create a very different set of requirements, no longer tying transportation, for example, to fossil fuels? How is Ukraine going to position itself in a world where geographies remain because of the role of renewables? So these are very important questions, all going back to the issue of threat and temptation and of old chains and new chains. I want to leave it here. I think we have a lot to discuss. And before I sign off, I want to thank all the institutions that contributed to making this project possible. The original name of this project was Chains of Value, Chains of Power. We changed the title for the book, but I would not have been able to do any of this without the support of HURI, of my university, and of many other institutions, in particular in the European Union, that supported me. So I'm gonna move back to Ben, and hopefully we can start an interesting discussion.
Well, thank you very much, Margarita. And can you hear me? Okay, well, thank you very much, Margarita. And hello, friends. Ben Schmidt here. I'm from the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics across campus. But I am a longtime friend of HURI, friend of Margarita, and friend of Ukraine. I have, as Megan mentioned, although I'm from an astrophysics background, I worked for 4 years at the U.S. Department of State, focused specifically on these sort of energy issues, supporting NATO's eastern flank nations against Russian energy dominance, in particular, working on the energy security of Ukraine. And I'll just say as a brief anecdote, when I entered the State Department as a science policy fellow back in 2015 in the Obama administration, I joined the European Energy Security Team in part because there was still some level of connection to the basic science and technology elements of the energy systems and the energy technologies involved, but also because it has a real high profile and extremely important geopolitical and national security impact on how the transatlantic relationship has developed and how transatlantic security is maintained. I was given a very small and not important profile or portfolio, but just small to begin with as a new diplomat to get my feet wet. So I had the Nordic and Baltic portfolios, so basically the Baltic Sea portfolio, and was focused. My original intention was to focus mostly on the Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonian energy security issues, including electricity grid decoupling from the former Soviet era grid. The independence terminal at Klaipeda, Lithuania for LNG imports and things like this, the Baltic Connector project between Estonia and in Finland. But 2 weeks after I started my tenure at the State Department, a small and not so high profile pipeline known as Nord Stream 2 was announced. And ultimately that basically kept me at the State Department from what was supposed to be about a year fellowship into a position that I did for 4 years working as European Energy Security Advisor, focused on these issues because, and I really felt that it was important to stay and important to continue to hold the line on a lot of these issues because of exactly what Margarita said in the manner in which she has written in her excellent book, and I've sadly only read the first section, just having received this yesterday. But I can already tell that this will go down as one of the seminal works on Russian energy geopolitics vis-a-vis the EU and the European continent writ large, and of course, with respect to Ukraine, in part because it really speaks to what I, as a practitioner of science and technology, think about when I think about these impacts of geoeconomic and geopolitical issues vis-a-vis European energy security topics. And that is looking at the way in which the infrastructure itself can be manifested to have a national security impact in one way or the other, and how the hardware, meaning the actual infrastructure, the upstream, midstream, downstream supply infrastructure of these energy systems can manifest themselves in a way that have a specific geopolitical aim or geoeconomic aim, but also that you really need to understand both sides of that same coin, which is to say, how do these actual systems, whether they're anything in the value chain from hydrocarbons through the electricity grid, through future energy technologies, renewables, and things like this, how they actually operate, how their own value chains work, and how they are transitioning us to a new energy technology environment and also a new geopolitical environment. And that's why, when we talk about energy security in Europe, and we saw Secretary Blinken speak at NATO headquarters as his first visit to the EU and or to the European Union region. And then of course he was in Ukraine just last week, working on mentioning energy security and reform efforts around energy as well. He has rightly emphasized the need to modernize the sort of threat vector responses that our alliances have in their toolkits. Our NATO partners and allies from the US standpoint, our partners in Ukraine, this includes the need to increase our innovation and capabilities in a variety of non-traditional national security sectors, because both Moscow, as Margarita points out in her book, and Beijing are increasingly projecting malign influence via critical infrastructure, emerging technologies, and using economic engagement for international coercion. And as a practicing physicist myself, this really hits home because all of these sectors need to have a close coordination across our alliances between senior diplomatic and national security officials on one side, and actually having practitioners of science and technology that need to be integrated into the national security diplomatic and senior policy planning processes in the US and EU to address these cross-cutting challenges. So with that that said, I really appreciate how this book is structured. I like the travelogue idea of the hydrocarbon resources from the Russian Federation through Eastern Europe into Western Europe being set up as a travelogue, because I think a lot of times this is missed in terms of how that value chain actually manifests itself. And then, you know, what are the impacts on Ukraine's national security? So we heard Margarita speak a lot about the economic impacts, things like arbitrage and things like transit fees and things like that. And those are often what we see as kind of the headline grabbing, you know, what may or may not the debate be over when it comes to Ukraine's role in Europeans energy sector. But I'm glad that Margarita has looked at the strategic elements as well, because that's what I really think about when I think about projects like Nord Stream 2 and how harmful they can be for not only Europe's energy security, but also Ukrainian economic and strategic stability itself. Because Ukraine, being a country that is being actively, having been actively invaded and at war with proxies of the Russian Federation in Donbass, and having illegally annexed Crimea itself, you really can look at these energy security issues and see that it's not just a commercial deal in a lot of cases. Because when you look at the strategic security elements of this, yes, Nord Stream 2, if it successfully comes online, gives Moscow the technical capability to cut off that value chain for gas transit via the Ukrainian gas transmission system, which Margarita rightly points out has a lot of considerations for, basically more than just a single pipeline itself. It's a pipeline network that has both pressure and gas delivery implications throughout its own, own national network in terms of distribution, but also exiting via Veliky Kapushani and elsewhere into the EU, and how we look at that. But when we look at the actual physical energy infrastructure, okay, yes, Nord Stream 2 would allow Moscow, along with its Turk Stream pipeline, to cut off and significantly reduce gas transit via Ukraine. We've already seen that the Russians have used Turk Stream, which is only 15.75 BCMA, to do this. When it came online on January 1st, 2020, while we were starting to think about the coronavirus pandemic, the gas interconnector between Ukraine and Romania dropped, basically that compressor station dropped its deliveries by roughly 90%. And over the course of the past year, we've seen a 70% drop off in gas transit via the traditional, what is known as the Trans-Balkan route. So Russia, Ukraine, Romania, Bulgaria, because this diversionary pipeline of Turk Stream was built. And if that is on a small scale what the Russians have done with Turk Stream, we can be sure that they will do the same with Nord Stream 2, which is 55 BCMA, a project that only is aimed at bringing up to 9.9 of that 55 BCMA to Germany and points west, but rather to bring most of the rest of that gas to the Baumgarten gas hub in Austria, which is the endpoint of the Ukrainian gas transmission route, meaning that this is really, from a technical, purely technical point of view, what the Russians have designed into the system to cut off Ukraine. And yes, it would result in up to $2 or $3 billion, depending on the year, in transit revenue losses. That's a few percent of Ukraine's GDP, and that's a major economic security concern. But also there are strategic security concerns, because the physical infrastructure, the actual gas pipelines that Russia still relies on, oftentimes if you overlay the locations of the line of contact in Donbass and the physical pipeline infrastructure, those pipelines that Russia still relies on circumscribe or are directly adjacent in some cases to that line of contact in Donbass. So were that reliance that the Russians have taken away, one can be sure that there would be one less strategic deterrent on extending Russian aggression to destabilize Ukraine further into Ukrainian territory. Not to say that the tanks, the gas pipeline is turned off and the tanks roll tomorrow or something like that, but just one less strategic deterrent. So that's something that needs to be thought of as well. Okay, So with that, I want to open this up to our panel. Maybe if everyone can turn on their videos, I would like to start with Paul, then Andras, and then Adrian, and get your comments on Marguerite's excellent book, excellent talk. And then after that, we'll open up to Q&A. And again, Margarita, congratulations. It's just a tremendous contribution to not only the academic world and the academic background on this important topic, but also on the transatlantic energy security and national security policy space. So thank you so much.
All right. Can you hear me?
We have Jackson, yes. Pollock on the line.
Ha. Can you hear me? Okay, good. Well, let me try to pick up where Ben left off, which is saying what a remarkable book this is. And I'll try to say a little bit about why I find it so remarkable. And then I'm going to put some questions to Margarita. Because one of the great things about this book is the quality of the analysis that allows us to ask some questions that up until now, I'm not sure we've really been able to conceptualize as well as we now can. So it's a unique and comprehensive look at energy politics that surround Russian energy supplies. Unique in this supply chain approach, but the supply chain approach, besides just being fascinating in itself to read sort of how these molecules or bits of material get transformed along the way, it also gives Margarita this analytical leverage to ask about a whole different set of relationships along the way, at some of the domestic relationships as well as transnational relationships, and to get at a much broader notion, therefore, of what actually constitutes power, right? Power to, as well as power over, is a big theme of this book. And of course, that's the very nature of energy, is it gives you power to do things, right? To drive cars or create heat or whatever it might be. So in this respect, it's a much more nuanced version of power and of energy power than we get in many existing, in much existing work, including my own. I think in particular, in the international relations literature, which is what I'm familiar with, this really builds off the work of Barnett and Duval in a way that's extremely fruitful. What's key to this in my estimation, and what the value chain allows Margarita to do, is to look at the merger of the domestic and the international. How not only does the movement of energy and the energy economy, how does it shape international politics and international power in different ways, but how does it shape domestic politics and domestic power, and how do those domestic and international power constellations relate to one another? And I'll just give sort of one example of, I think, what this allows us to see more clearly, which is Margarita mentioned my book, which is very old now. But at that time in the 1990s, it was pretty easy to see that sooner or later, Russia was going to build gas pipelines around Ukraine. And you didn't need to be a genius to figure this out. You just needed to look at the situation. And the question was, given the time it's going to take, the 10 or 15 or 20 years one could guess it was going to take, what will Ukraine do in the meantime to reduce its dependence? So now it's 2021, Russia's built the pipelines, Nord Stream 2 is gonna come online within the next few years. And in many respects, I would say reform in Ukraine has been minimal. In fact, most of what's been done in Ukraine has really been done by the European Union as much as by Ukraine. How do we explain those differences? Russia very cagely, right? Dedicating a lot of resources to this power relationship, and Ukraine dithering. Well, the explanation for that really is about I think Margarita's analysis allows us to see this, it's about the domestic economics within Ukraine. The fact that there's a lot of important and powerful Ukrainian people who are getting massively enriched and are creating a lot of power within Ukraine, even as Ukraine's power vis-a-vis Russia looks like it's going to ebb even further. And so that's a really crucial part of the analysis that this value chain approach allows us to see. And of course, Margarita's previous work allowed us to see that as well. I like to say, and it's of course a huge exaggeration, but I like to say that in a nutshell, Ukrainian politics is about who is going to control and benefit from the corruption that comes from gas transit. And I think Russia's of course been very aware of this. And so this reminds me of dependency theory, which is an academic school of thought that's very much out of vogue, but you kind of see it coming through in this work. As I read the book that I was looking for that I didn't find, it's a very specific thing. And so we should be clear, this is not a big criticism. But one of the most interesting examples of temptation involves a guy named Gerhard Schröder, who really doesn't play much of a role in the book. There's a couple of mentions of him, but I wanted 10 pages examining how it was that Schröder, and really by extension, one of the major political parties in Germany, came to become more or less agents of the Russian government. Did the Russians use leverage to do this? My sense is it wasn't about leverage. It was more about temptation. There was so much money on the table that people like Schröder and a lot of other elites in Western Europe just couldn't resist and still can't resist. And so this part of power, which is people want to make friends with Russia, with Gazprom, with Putin, simply because there's so much financial benefit from doing so, is a different kind of power than the one we typically think of. And while I think Margarita's book, in a general sense, lays that out quite well, I wanted to read more about Schröder in particular, because I think it's one of the great underemphasized stories of this whole issue of the last 30 years is the Russians basically bought the German chancellor and most of the SPD while they were at it. So because I, though, in particular focused on Ukraine, let me ask three questions and then I'll be quiet. First is, what does this analysis tell us then about the possibility for reform in Ukraine? My reading of the book says, number one, that there's so much money behind the status quo that it's simply unrealistic to expect Ukraine to change. Or put slightly differently, there's so much economic benefit for so many powerful people to not reform that you can't expect them. You can't expect people to do things that have such huge negative incentives. And we saw the Ukrainian, one of the major Ukrainian figures in the Ukrainian energy business was fired last week, which most people saw as a step backwards. So there's a question for Western policy, whether we should stop even thinking that this is possible and maybe come up with a different plan. A second question, of course, and Ben touched on this, is what happens when Nord Stream 2 comes online and the current transit agreement expires? It's not just that Ukraine is in big trouble, which we know about, right? And Ben pointed out $2 to $3 billion in revenue lost. That's a big chunk of Ukrainian GDP. But what I also really want to get at, and this connects back to the first question, is a big chunk of that $2 to $3 billion is basically being siphoned off and is feeding corruption in Ukraine, but then being funneled back into battles over political power in Ukraine. So when we take that $2 to $3 billion out, right, what happens to Ukrainian politics? What happens to that fight over the revenues of corruption? And what happens to all the political activity that's being funded by those illicit resources? So the point is that Margarita's book allows us really to ask about is not just what the international consequences of a change in the value chain are, but what are the domestic political consequences going to be in Ukraine? And I would love to hear Margarita's thoughts on that. And then the third one is Russia, through its proxies in Donbass, is now occupying some of the key territories where this story takes place, right? The coal basin of the Donbass, a lot of these vast metallurgical processing areas of the Donbass. And that then relates to the question of how that reshapes power within Ukraine. And we know some of this, and Margarita has written about this, in particular about Akhmetov, but also about how this reshapes then the power relations between Ukraine and Russia. Because my sense is that Russia has taken a whole bunch of problems off Ukraine's hands in Donbass. Both economic problems and political problems, and has probably weakened some of the most pro-Russian political forces in Ukraine, which seems to me like a misstep for someone like Putin, who is regarded as such a master tactician. So that's really my third question, is how the occupation reshapes the power that comes out of some of these value chains. Anyhow, I'll wind up by saying again, I can ask questions like this because Margarita's done this incredible work and presented it in this incredibly, not just novel, but fruitful way of thinking about these things in terms of value chains. So bravo, Margarita, and I will stop there.
Well, thank you, Paul. So what I'll do is take the moderator's prerogative here. And Margarita, if we could collect the answers to those questions and we'll do them all at once. So we'll have Andrush and Adrian. I also will add to the to Paul's excellent question, because that was, he stole right out of my mouth what I was going to ask right when I opened it for Q&A. I did want to ask you about dynamics of Schroederization or Schroederization, as it were. And so I'll add just a little bit to his question so you can answer that at the same time. But thank you so much, Paul. And Andrush, over to you.
Oh, thank you very much. Do you hear me, actually? Oh, fine. So I collected three basic comments, two on the book and the last one on the title of the current seminar. And I would like to keep the 8 to 10 minutes, what is my time limit, actually. So the first one, when I read the book, I had always the impression that this is a travel book. So this is not only molecules traveling, but also Margarita traveling somewhere between Russia and Europe. So I could imagine her standing at an oil well in Siberia, in Avdiivka, the coal processing plant, or at Varga Kapushina, the gas distribution factory. This very much comes from the elementary wish of any energy researcher, energy expert, to visit the facilities of the energy value chain anywhere. So I also started with 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago, by visiting power plants, speaking to technicians, having an insight. This is something what belongs to the field, let me say so. And I'm very happy that in virtuality or in reality, Margarita could do this travel. So if you read this book, I also recommend, it is written so that you read it as a, to some extent, as a travel book. The other merit why I like, usually I ask myself when I read a book that what was the message, and whether this message, whether I will read it, this book 10 years later, or whether I will read it in the same way and in 2030. And in my understanding, it has a very enduring content. As you may know, Margarita discusses 2011-2014, this 3-4 year period. And in my understanding, this was the zenith of the EU-Russia energy relationship. So this was the very peak. And in my understanding, this book is a snapshot or a picture from a peak, both in terms of volume, how much energy was traded between Europe and Russia, and in terms of value, in terms of money. So if you look at the sheer numbers, in the last 10 years, the European coal demand fell by more than one third. Oil imports, oil consumption fell by more than 15%. Gas is the last stronghold, maybe. It has changed in very many ways. So it may come back to some extent, but still, I don't think that the conditions and the prices will be the same as they were in 2011 anymore. If there are some doubts that this is something temporary, I don't think so. So if you look at the European side and the climate neutrality as a policy goal, this can be understood as a farewell to the fossil fuel, farewell to the value chains in the fossil fuel business and Russia. So in my understanding, one of the merits of this book that it looks back to a almost 50 year long period, at the very top of that, how it stands, how it exists. And this is a very good fundament to look how this relationship is going to change and decline, and how it is going to withdraw from this level. It is, I think, one of the most interesting things in the story. Usually people think about decline as something bad or a farewell. Well, neither in economic nor in political terms, this is not that bad always. So in terms of profitability, it is one of the most profitable period of any value chain, because you don't have to invest any more into infrastructure. You can say, okay, this is enough. I can take the profits and bring them home. So in this regard, I was very happy that this book has been done at a very specific period. It is quite important. And at last, about the title of the discussion, Threat or Temptation. In my understanding, this is a very American, Russian and Ukrainian question. So in Western Europe, this is not the only question anymore. So the big question is how fast we can get rid of this infrastructure and all these fuels, and what to do with the infrastructure. So if you look at natural gas was my part, I had to read it. So one issue is this geopolitical debate about Nord Stream 2, what to do with it, what will happen to Ukraine, how these flows will happen. But if you ask the policy people and sectoral people, they try to persuade politicians that natural gas has a future, or at least the infrastructure. And they would like to get money for hydrogen, for biogas. They are trying to sell their product. And they are a little bit desperate because they see that natural gas does not get any funding within the EU anymore. When the commissioner for EU enlargement tried to offer for the Balkans, the Western Balkan states, gas investments in the commission, in the European Commission, seven DGs vetoed this proposal. Absolutely unprecedented, even at the level of the commission, the seven veto arise. No more funding for fossil fuels, neither in the EU and to a lesser extent in the EU neighborhood. In this regard, on the one hand, there is a US-Russian geopolitical game. On the other hand, within the EU, we have a totally different logic. I'm not saying that this is good or bad. I'm just saying this is existing, that we have to get rid of the fossil fuels as soon as possible. And I think when we speak about Nord Stream 2 or threat or temptation or Ukraine, this also has to be taken into account. And one of the biggest longer term threat for Ukrainian gas industry is the fact that Europe will not buy natural gas in the longer run at all, neither from Russia nor from anywhere else. I would like to stop here. And I also would like to congratulate for you, Margarita. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andras. And then finally, Adrian, we could have your comments.
Hello, everyone. So I'm extremely happy that this fantastic book was already published. And I got acquainted with the idea of the book the same time that I got acquainted with Margarita 6 years ago, in 2015, when we had this fantastic scholarship in Woodrow Wilson Center. And we spent so many hours discussing the book, ideas. So that was fantastic. I'm really happy that Margarita has finished with this. And in her book, she tells the story in an excellent way. That is story of energy transformed to final goods and who and how was involved in this, covering both spatial issues, the roots, and technological. I think it will not be very loud if I say that the book gives the reader encyclopedic knowledge. So many the reader can gain from the book on gas, oil, coal, on history, how it was developed and transformed. it's perfect from my point of view. And just to imagine that, what a great job Margarita had to do, how many sources she started, how many people from different countries and industries she had to talk to. And beside this, so I know that Margarita conducted a lot of these workshops to discuss the book, to have critics, to have advice. So that was fantastic job was done. A few words about the methodology. Actually, I told Margarita all these things earlier. So I think very good that was done about opening this box of energy dependence and energy weapon. Because what people talk about, they just don't realize how things works. They do not distinguish about different energy sources. They do not distinguish and do not talk about different issues impacting on coal or oil transportation or transformation. The second thing, that is a very good contribution to understanding this black box. The second point that Margarita paid a lot of attention to these commercial nodes where energy is transformed or goods are transformed on this value chain. And the third point that besides understanding just the value chain, Margarita did a great work studying it from political side, how these value chains impacted on political and economic players in different nodes, and how these players affected these value chains in general. And besides others, so I was reading about this coal value chain that Margarita said that was extremely difficult and interesting. And it's very good that Margarita has chosen exactly coke coal, because the value chain is much more longer and much more interesting, much more sophisticated. And I liked this, what was mentioned. So from the coke in coal to why a wind power plants in Germany. That's interesting also because of this energy transition point. So that's a very good set. Margarita tells very good. It gives very good understanding how Ukrainian coal sector was developed. Very good understanding of Kuzbass coal production. Explains why dependence of Ukraine on Russian coal was increasing. What was happening to Ukrainian coal industry, coal mines, why these were subsidized, why the sector wasn't reformed, who benefited from it. Both some specific oligarchs and the state in general. Margarita tells the story, tells the history, so how Ukrainian this metallurgy production appeared, how it was developing, and finishing it with how Ukrainian steel got to the European Union, and so what Ukrainian key players were doing to enter these markets. So in general, so just having read 50 pages, a reader can gain a lot of information and a lot of knowledge about the story of these relations and this transformation. So that was an excellent story, the same as gas and oil. And sure that the period that Margarita studied, which actually finished in 2014, so many has changed since the time, I think this contributed a lot for us to understand better how things will change in the future, because sure, Ukrainian energy sector and economics are facing very serious changes. These are about decarbonization, and these are about decreasing importance of Ukraine in gas transit. That is what about coal mines in Ukraine. So all Ukrainian state-owned coal mines are unprofitable and deeply subsidized. and demand for coal will be decreasing in next 20 years. And these companies who are rent-seeking from this will just leave the sector, and state will have the serious problem what to do with this. And another problem state has, how to find Ukraine in a new gas market. Sure, there are a lot of talks about hydrogen, that Ukraine may be an important player in European hydrogen market, and biomethane, biogas. So I think this will be also interesting story for Margarita to follow. But so in general, I'm very happy that this great book was published, and I hope that someday I will manage to write the same good book as Margarita. Thanks.
Great, thank you so much, Adrian. So, okay, that's a lot of questions. We also have questions from the audience. I just wanna frame, as I said, I was going to do the question, and I think I'd love to hear as the first question that Margarita addresses this question of the Schroederization of Europe, because for decades, German foreign policy towards the Soviet Union and then the Russian Federation have been based on this concept of Ostpolitik, that you would have Wandel durch Handel, or change through trade. And this was reinvigorated in the early 2000s by then German Chancellor Gerhard Schroeder. And the concept states that supposedly by increasing trade relations with authoritarian regimes, most notably Putin's Kremlin in recent years, Western regulatory norms and rule of law would naturally flow upstream, the idea to slowly transform those kleptocracies into liberal democratic states. But more than 15 years after Schroeder has left office, there's been a lot of Handel or trade without much Kremlin Wandel to show for it or change. Over the past decade, Moscow has illegally annexed territory in Ukraine and Georgia, launched cyber attacks and disinformation campaigns, assassinated and poisoned an array of political opposition figures at home and abroad. And as all of this has happened, Putin continues to find support in corners of Europe for especially energy mega deals like Nord Stream 2 and Turk Stream. And that's really what I think is one of the biggest issues of our time when we talk about the national security implications of these sort of projects and the sort of value chains that you wrote about in your book, Margarita, because we see that, yes, okay, so Gerhard Schroeder supported the Nord Stream 1 project while in office, stepped out and immediately became a senior board member for Nord Stream AG, the managing company that's wholly owned by Russian state-owned and Kremlin-controlled Gazprom. Tellingly, Schroeder's closest German colleague in these companies is a gentleman by the name of Matthias Warnich, a close Putin confidant and ex-Stasi officer who was named in Russian opposition leader Alexei Navalny's widely circulated anti-corruption video earlier this year as a key figure in Putin's orbit of corruption. And he's also been a leading manager of Nord Stream and is now the CEO of Nord Stream 2, and a member of supervisory boards of Rosneft and sanctioned Russian state bank VTB. The list goes on and on when we talk about similar Schroederized officials in Austria. Former Austrian Chancellor Christian Kern came out in favor of Nord Stream 2 and other pro-Russian policies while in office, and stepped out and was for a brief period of time on the board of Russian railways. A number of others have done this, including former Austrian Foreign Minister Karin Kneissl, who Putin famously danced with at her wedding, bringing a Cossack choir to the ceremony. And just two short years later, Kneissl started working as a commentator after leaving office for Russian state propaganda network RT, writing on Nord Stream 2 for the outlet. And earlier this year, Kneissl apparently, you know, quote unquote, waltzed her way to being advanced as a nominee to become a member of the supervisory board of Rosneft. The salary of a new independent member of Rosneft's board, by the way, on its website is $530,000 per year. So my question, and I think I'd like to just go into this based on what Paul said, what are the strategic implications of all of this use of Russian energy resources and energy infrastructure projects for strategic corruption? Do you think that there's any way that Germany can be convinced or evolve on this to get by its Wandel durch Handel, which I think was admirable many decades ago, is at least a concept, but clearly has seen this flow of authoritarian corruption, at least the appearance of it, come downstream into the European Union rather than exporting regulatory norms, EU market liberalization, things like this, upstream into the Russian Federation.
Thank you. I'll give a couple of comments on that question. I don't want to take the entire Q&A period on it because I think there's a couple of others that also want to jump in. I think the strength of what Ben has called the Schroederization of German policy is very clear. And I think it goes back to the tremendous importance that this collaboration with Gazprom has had, not only for politicians, but for German companies and for good or for bad, for former East German government officials that have now turned that expertise into commercial expertise. The question, and obviously that has very important strategic implications for Ukraine. Will this change? If we stay in a fossil fuel world, I see that as unlikely to change in the near future. But as the European Union, as András was mentioning when he was talking, is moving increasingly away from fossil fuels, that may make that entire branch of business less profitable and remove some of the incentives that companies in Germany, in Norway, in Austria have had for collaborating with that for those projects. So I think that is perhaps one area where larger changes may affect the situation. However, I do want to point to a larger question that is related to this and that I pose in the very last pages of my book, which is, what is the moral responsibility of Germany, German companies, Western European countries vis-a-vis Ukraine? When you are in Germany listening to the debates or the discussion on Nord Stream, the dominant discourse, especially from the commercial actors, is that this is more economically advantageous. We know that it's more economically advantageous because of the terms that Gazprom has given these companies, but they continue to talk about it in broader terms. They do not present it in terms of responsibility vis-a-vis Ukraine. So my question is, can this change without Ukraine becoming more visible? Every time I discuss this with people in Germany, very often they say, we want to keep good relations with Russia, not only because it is economically good for us or for our companies, but because we have a moral responsibility vis-a-vis Russia, stemming from the Second World War. Where is Ukraine in that moral responsibility? Where is Ukraine in that consciousness? I think without Ukraine becoming more visible in that consciousness, it's gonna be harder for a public opinion push or a public opinion argument to be made to support Ukraine in the Nord Stream issue. So I'll leave it at that, but I simply want to flag that that is an important way of looking at the questions, at that question. Should I get to the other questions that Paul asked?
Yeah, if you could. So just as an announcement for everyone, we will be going until 1:45. That's, of course, if you agree to that, Margarita. We'd sure. like to continue to hear from you. We had a lot of question posing. We want to hear all of the answers. So if you'd like to start by answering Paul's other questions, then we can go to the audience. I'll ask some of those questions to you, and we can continue going for another 20 minutes
or so. Let me get to one of the questions that Paul posed, which I think is a really interesting question, both in terms of domestic politics and international politics. Is there a possibility for reform? If so many actors have benefited from those value chains or from corruption around those value chains, is there a possibility for reform? And I want to remind you that some of those value chains are under crisis. If you read about oil, not only has Ukraine's role in oil transit from Russia declined from 50% to 17%, but the entire refinery sector in Ukraine, which was indirectly related to that export role and transit role, has disintegrated. So there is possibility for change. It's coming from outside, not necessarily from the European Union only, but also from the behavior of Russian actors. However, those oligarchs that benefited from gas transit, from oil transit, they have found a variety of ways to diversify their portfolio. We know now, for example, that key oligarchs are active not only in particular sectors, but in broader sectors. So for example, we have Akhmetov, who is active not only in the coal sector and metallurgical sector, which are of course very closely related, but also in the renewable energy sector. We have gas oligarchs, which are all involved in electricity production and nuclear production. So the value chains are not eternal. We have seen an end of those value chains as we knew it. That is most clear in the case of the oil value chain with the disintegration of the refinery sector in Ukraine. That's visible in the gas sector as well. But oligarchs have been able to tap into other sources of profit and corruption having to do with other sectors of the economy. So what does the situation in Donbass tell us? Well, it's extremely interesting because what we have seen in Donbass with the way in which coal and metallurgical value chains have been disrupted is that key players such as Akhmetov in the first 3 years after the conflict started, they found ways of keeping those value chains flowing until 2017, when there was a blockade started actually by Ukrainian veterans who were not happy with this trade with the enemy. He was able to maintain physical assets in the occupied or quote unquote separatist territories, while officially having those companies formally located in Kyiv-controlled territory. That situation has become much more untenable now. However, because of the changes in the global economy related to the pandemic and so on, we know that steel is once again greatly increasing in price and Akhmetov's assets also. So that is a very important issue, and it's an issue where Ukraine or areas under Kyiv control have suffered because of the severance of those ties. But let's remember also that in that area, you have other types of infrastructure, including gas infrastructure, including water infrastructure, where areas under Moscow control are actually dependent on Ukrainian infrastructure. So the discussion about peace or reintegration of those territories also has an infrastructural level that we seldom discuss, but which is also very important. I'm gonna leave it at here, and maybe we can go to some of the other questions, depending on what Ben has in his
thanks, thanks so much, Margarita. Okay, so we'll now open the Q&A session from the audience for the next 16 minutes that we have. From an absolute friend of mine and friend of Hurry, or Hurry VIP maybe, Mariana Budrin, who says, thank you, Margarita, for a fantastic talk and looking forward to reading the book. She just bought it. And I'll point out that if you'd like to buy this book, you can order a copy of the book through Columbia University Press and use code CUP20, C-U-P-2-0, to receive 20% off. So that's the book commercial in the middle of that question that I've just inserted. Okay, so she just bought it. Two questions she has. Number one, you have talked about the threats and temptations for Ukraine and the EU. What are the threats and temptations for Russia in these value chains? And second, Mariana asks, could you talk a bit about your sources for this research?
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much. It's fantastic to have you here and to have your questions. Threats and temptations for Russia. The temptation for Russia, of course, has been the first and foremost, the hard currency earnings from those exports. That is the number one temptation. Secondly, especially until the mid, until around 2015, the ability to shape the governance of whole economic sectors through its exports. And again, this is something that started during the Soviet period, but when we look at the expansion of Soviet, for example, natural gas, it was not simply about those profits that the Soviet Union could make, it shaped the governance of the sector, not only in the Soviet Union, but throughout Europe. That's also a temptation. Third is, of course, the personal profit that individuals can make from this. We know that Nord Stream 2 is not really viable as a more economical way of transiting natural gas, but it is very viable and very profitable for the contractors, which are not only lining the pipeline, contracting the subcontractors and so on. There are many, many branches of the Nord Stream 2 family, not only in Germany, but in Russia. So the temptation there for individual contractors, pipeline, technology companies, it's very, very, very key. What is the threat? Being tied to a fossil fuel world when the world is changing. Not being able to adapt to a decarbonized world. There are some talks about this, but there has been some adaptation on the Russian side, and not so much to decarbonization, but to, for example, the importance of liquefied natural gas, some, but Russia continues to be tied to a fossil fuel world, and that is something that is not viable in the long term. My sources. So it's not always possible to, in 2020, visit all the places you would like to visit. Unfortunately, people in particularly in Russia think it's very suspicious that somebody with my name and with my biography studies what it studies and is an associate at URI. It's a pity. But I have been able to use many commercial sources. So I have extensively used the reports, the yearly reports of all the companies that I am dealing with here, buried in the fine print in three or four different languages, you sometimes do find the key information you need. I have also used many interviews and many conversations. I have used materials from judicial procedures, both at the European Union and in US and Canadian judicial procedures, where some of the commercial information that is not available elsewhere is available. So some of you may not be familiar with this, but even basic information such as the price of natural gas that is paid is considered commercial secret. So it's very hard to get at this. But sometimes, for example, when there is a trial, for example, for a dumping procedure, for example, Canada versus certain companies or the European Union, then you get that information. So I had to be creative about the source of information. Of course, I use primary sources whenever possible. I benefited tremendously with all the conversations I had with politicians and commercial actors in the three countries involved and elsewhere in the European Union, but you had to dig very deep in some cases. And I wish I could have done more on the ground, but I'm happy that I was able to get an objective view, piecing together the different sources of information that I had, that I have available. And I spent a lot of time trying to make sure that that was the case. Thank you.
Thanks, Marguerite. That's just fascinating. I really appreciate your answer on what's in it for the companies involved in Nord Stream 2. It's not necessarily the commerciality, as I often say, of the project itself, but rather all of the as you said, the you have to look at the technology side and the value chain side on the subcontractors and the contractors that are working on this in the Russian Federation, as you rightly point out, it allows opportunities for domestic corruption and things like this. And you obviously have seen a number of the major contracts for the upstream portion of Nord Stream 2 and then the midstream pipelines from the Yamal Peninsula to Ust-Lunga on the Baltic Sea go to a currently US sanctioned Russian oligarchs, the Rotenberg brothers and Timchenko, and of course the five Western European companies. What's in it for them? Well, they may not be in this necessarily for the project itself, but rather they signed asset swap agreements for access in upstream in the Russian Federation and other parts of their value chain and other sectors, oil and gas, hydrocarbon sectors, a few of them, most notably BASF Wintershall and OMFOW.
Exactly, yes.
Just within 2 weeks of the original announcement in 2015. I remember seeing that in real time and being quite shocked by that. So thank you. That's and of course, just really interesting on the sources and the sort of investigation you've done. The next question we have comes from an anonymous attendee who asks, can you comment on the recent article by Pierre Noël of Columbia University in Foreign Policy, How to Break the Logjam Over Nord Stream 2? I pulled this up and I'll just read a couple of sentences that I remember reading about a week ago when this came out and framing the author's points on this. And in spite of all of the discussion and analysis that you've shared in your book and talked about today, and then the panelists and myself have talked about with respect to Nord Stream's threat to Ukraine strategic security, the spread of elite capture, strategic corruption, and threats to various parts of the value chain, the author in this says, quote, contrary to the claims of the pipeline's vociferous opponents, Nord Stream 2 will have no implications on European security whatsoever, end quote. Also says, quote, changing the logistics of Russian gas exports to Europe is strategically benign, end quote. And finally, quote, Nord Stream 2 makes sense for Europe and has no adverse strategic implications, end quote. So with those sort of very declarative statements, what do you have to say in response to that article, Margarita?
Yeah, so I have not read the article. I was traveling the last week, but I'm familiar with his work. And that argument only makes sense if you conceptualize Europe as Western Europe, and if you conceptualize Europe in terms of the interest of specific European companies that are participating in the project. If you look at Europe in terms of simply how much Russian gas will it receive, then you can make an argument. Yes, then you agree. But if you conceptualize Europe as a larger entity, an entity where Ukraine's role is also important, then I cannot agree with that argument. Now, I cannot answer whether Europe needs to have a responsibility vis-a-vis Ukraine. In the final analysis, in my view, this is a question of, does Western Europe, does European Union feel a moral responsibility vis-a-vis Ukraine because of the past, because of Ukraine's role in Europe or not? That is the question. It's not for me to answer it. But if you conceptualize the question simply in terms of how much Russian natural gas will Europe get, you may say, well, perhaps Pierre Noël has a point in this article. However, if you bilateralize the relationship between European consumers and Russia, that's not going to make it easier for them either. I think it's going to make them even more themselves more vulnerable to Russia. So I haven't read the article, but that would be my take on it.
Thank you, Margarita. The next question we have comes from Lyuba Levchuk, who asks and says, thank you, first of all, very interesting analysis. How can you make end user, in this case, the EU, take responsibility for supporting, quote, crazy Nord Stream, unquote, chain and share all the risks. Thanks for your work.
Okay, I need to hear the question again. I wasn't sure exactly about it.
How can you make the end user, the European Union, take responsibility for supporting the, quote, crazy Nord Stream, end quote, chain and share all of the risks? In other words, how does the EU share in the risk that Ukraine has for the EU support of Nord Stream?
So how to make EU policy change? Well, I think part of this will come from making the EU realize that the future is not in fossil fuels, but this has an downside for Ukraine as well, right? And part of this will come by exposing to public opinion the real role of some companies in benefiting from Nord Stream through the unique terms, and this is something Ben was mentioning just a minute ago, the unique terms that Gazprom has provided to them. Without this coming into the open, without transparency on this, I don't think this is possible.
Okay, and then the last two questions, one from the chat and one from Hurry Teacup Chair Emily Channel Justice, both have to do with green energy. I'll read Emily's question that came in from YouTube. Quote, can you comment more on the turn to green energy in Europe? You mentioned players like Akhmatova entering into that area for further profit, but is there enough space for others to do this? And if other EU countries turn to green energy infrastructure, does Ukraine lose its important place in the value chain and thus its political leverage? That's from Emily and from Bodan from the chat. We have, how can Ukraine accelerate the turn away from fossil fuels? Can this serve as a political vector towards the EU and the US with reference to climate change and sustainable development? And that's going to be our last set of questions. And I think it is a really important thing to think about as we go forward and we work on our collective response to climate change. So I think it's a great way to end this and talk about the future, basically where your book was, the trajectory of the book has gone towards looking at what are the next decades bring in terms of Ukraine's energy security and the interplay with the green energy technology deployment revolution.
That is indeed the biggest challenge for Ukraine moving forward. Green energy is here to stay in the European Union. If you look at the way European funds are being invested, it's going into green energy. Everything is about decarbonization. So what does this mean for Ukraine? Well, if Ukraine puts emphasis on transit of fossil fuels from Russia, it's still betting on it through hoping that Nord Stream 2 will not happen and natural gas will continue to be transited via Ukraine. But if the European Union in 30, 40 years starts importing less natural gas, this will obviously affect the role of Ukraine, even if Nord Stream would not be there. So it's a key issue. And I think we should be also here in the US paying much more attention to this. How can Ukraine play a larger role in green energy? Ukraine has many preconditions for playing a larger role in green energy. Andrian Prokop himself has worked a lot on this. Making it more profitable in comparison with fossil fuels will help, but this is an area where transparent legislation will also be very important. And that has been, in the case of electricity and green electricity, it has been a bit of a problem in Ukraine. But since we are running out of time, I simply want to emphasize that this is really one key area where we need to be looking at. How is Ukraine going to survive and perhaps even lead in a decarbonized world? So succumb, survive, or lead? These are questions that Ukraine will need to look at as new chains, new specialities, and new challenges emerge from the move to decarbonized energy.
Well, on that incredibly important call to action, Margarita, I really want to thank you so much for all of your wisdom that you've shared with us today. both technical, geopolitical, geoeconomic, technopolitical, as you talk about in the book. Thank you for everything you've done on this issue set, especially your focus over the past 6 years as you've developed this book and of course work before that. Thanks also to Adrian Prokip, Andres Thiek, and Paul Dineri for your excellent contributions to this discussion. Really appreciate you having here. And of course to everyone that has been in the audience and offered such great questions and contributions to the discussion, and of course to the Harvard Ukraine Research Institute for hosting this important discussion today. Just to close this out, a reminder that we were discussing, if anyone came in late, Russian energy chains, the remaking of technopolitics from Siberia to Ukraine to the European Union, which Margarita Balmaseda just had come out yesterday. So again, order a copy of the book through Columbia University Press and use code CUP20 to receive 20% off. There's a link in the chat. And most of all, just read it because it's really fundamentally important to everything that we talk about in the transatlantic security space. And it's not a niche issue. You know, energy security is often seen as, you know, something over here that, you know, there's the policy world and the high-flying diplomatic and national security world. And then there's, you know, this very niche area called energy and energy security. It's not. It's all part of that same broad geopolitical, geoeconomic, and you know, sustainable technology future that we will have together in an increasingly globalized and interconnected energy world. And that's fundamentally important to our collective national security. And of course, the national security and strategic stability of Ukraine, which we're talking about today. So Margarita, thank you so much for your contribution to this field and everyone else for this great discussion. And I'll turn this back over to Megan.
Awesome. Yes, I will merely jump on Ben's enthusiastic thank you to everybody involved. That was really, really, really interesting. So thank you. Congratulations again to Margarita. And then since this is our final seminar of the spring term, I just wanted to add that our Harvard Ukrainian Summer Institute public lecture series will kick off again in late June, and it will meet virtually on Friday afternoons at 1:15 Boston time. So I hope you can all join us for that. We have an exciting lineup this summer, and we will announce our full schedule shortly. So thank you again to all of you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, everybody.